We've been united by divisive events. We must use this moment to continue to make progress. Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. Show Racism the Red Card's annual Wear Red Day will be taking place on the 22nd of October. Wear red and raise money to fund anti-racism education across the UK. Together, we can make a difference. Text RED to 70470 to donate £1 and visit theredcard.org for more information.
Change hearts, change minds, change lives.
Hi, Shaka Hislop here again, Honorary President of Show Racism the Red Card. Delighted to join you to another of our 25 and 25 podcasts as we celebrate our 25th anniversary. I'm delighted to be joined by writer, filmmaker, historian, David Olusoga.
This is 25 for 25, a Show Racism the Red Card podcast. Make sure you subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and YouTube.
Most proudly, may I offer a Geordie from Gateshead, Newcastle. Is that right, David?
Right. I was brought up in an area called Bensham and then moved to an area called Chipcote in Gateshead. Lived there my entire youth before I went off to university. So yeah, a Geordie, a Nigerian Geordie. So there's lots of Nigerian Geordies and there's lots of Nigerians. Geordies have played for Newcastle United.
That's right. Well, as a Trinidadian Geordie, I'm right there alongside you in kinship, and I'm wonderful city that still holds so many great memories for me. Of course, it was just after I joined Newcastle that we started recently Red Card, and never thinking that some 25 years on we'd still be here. It was meant as just us players going into schools, talking about our experiences, trying to make an impact in our communities. And speaking of that impact in communities, what was your experience like growing up in Newcastle and in the Northeast in the 70s?
I had two halves to my life. I came from a big, close family, and inside the house, we had, I think a very positive experience. My mother was she's a remarkable woman. She really believed in self-education. She came from that sort of Northeastern tradition of self-improvement and education being at the center of everything. And she worked incredibly hard to get her children good educations. You know, she's my siblings have gone on to do things because of the groundwork that she did. So I had a very happy and close kind of big family life. But outside of the home, it was really difficult. Schools were places where racism was just seen as another kind of taunt, another sort of a form of bullying, not something to worry about. Teachers were very non-interventionist about race. And it was a time when, you turned on the television and there was the Black and White Minstrel Show was on television. And I was 8 years old when the Black and White Minstrel Show was finally cancelled. The comedians, people like Jim Davidson, were everywhere with racial impersonations. And when I talk to young Black British people, they kind of don't get just how different things were in the 70s and 80s. And that's great that it seems like another world to them. But it was a world where there was racism everywhere. And I had racism from teachers at school. I had racism from older men on the street when I was still a child. And we had racial violence. I'm not unusual in any way about this, but I'm someone who carries the physical as well as the sort of emotional scars of racial violence from those years. And those experiences are very, very common. I think the Northeast was a little different because there was such a small Black community that I think some of the character of racism as it appeared in London or something was quite different. But it was still, I think it was not a great time to be a Black person, a Black kid growing up in Britain.
There was one story I heard that Paul Gascoigne came to see you after reports of your own suffering some racial incident. I'm not sure exactly what the incident is.
3 years above me was a classmate, which was my sister, my older sister Yinka, and also Paul Gascoigne. And I only have one strong memory of Paul, which was I remember him picking me up from the playground. I'd been hit, knocked over by some kids who didn't like me and my sister because we were the only non-white kids. I remember sort of Paul, he liked my sister and was friends with my sister, sort of picking me up and sort of dusting me down and then sort of running off because he was always running. That's the only memory I have of him. He was a kid who was always running around. So he was sort of, you know, one of the kind of tough kids who looked after and looked out for, you know, me and my sister. And I didn't have to do that. I'm sure it wasn't the way to be popular to be someone who sort of looked after the, you know, looked out for the two black kids. But, you know, but he did that. So I don't have very strong memories of being at school, and we only overlapped by 1 year. But I do remember that very, very well, of him sort of kind of coming to my aid, as it were, when people were pushed me over and hit me.
I think Paul Gascoigne was that kind of person. I remember with myself getting called into the England national team a little bit surprisingly back in 1998. I arrived on the bus. Nobody kind of knew people knew who I was, but I had no friends, no teammates on the team as well. And Paul Gascoigne is the one who kind of brought me into the group, invited me in, and all of a sudden, I was accepted, and people started speaking with me. So I what you say about Paul is exactly my memory of him. He really was that kind of person. I spoke with Shamal George, goalkeeper at Colchester United, who recently received racism, and he felt things were getting worse. And I remember after the podcast, speaking to my daughter, a recent university graduate herself, about his answer and how I felt about the racism that I received as a player, and speaking to players like John Barnes or Viv Anderson. And I spoke to Luther Blissett a few weeks ago about what they endured. And her outlook, her response was, this generation tends to be more forward-looking as opposed to paying close attention to the history. Is that something you found in speaking to young people in your work today? How are their perceptions around racism in today's society? How does that play off against some of the historical narratives?
Well, I think it's interesting. I think young people in Britain, particularly young black people, I don't think they understand how bad racism was in the post-war period in the 60s, 70s, 80s. And I think there's one of the reasons for that is that people of my generation and the generation earlier haven't really talked about it. We have this siege mentality. Bad things happened. We absorbed them. We moved on. And when things got better, we didn't want to bring up those unpleasant experiences. So it's kind of our fault that we haven't shared this history. There is a great oral history to be done of experiences of black people in Britain, just in my lifetime in the 70s and the 80s, because those histories are really important. And when I'm always talking to black people around my age, and I'm shocked by their experiences, and they're very similar to mine. I've just done an event with David Harewood, the great actor, and it was about his new memoir, and he talks about, you know, being chased and being fearful of the National Front. And we haven't made TV programs about those experiences. There's no great book. There's no national conversation about that period. So I think it's not really the fault of young people that they don't know that history, because we haven't talked about it. But I think there's also something really quite complex going on, which is that I think if you understand the history, there's no question that things are better now than they were 20, 30 years ago. But something else has happened in recent years, which is that racism and expressions of racism have found a new outlet, which is the world of online, the world of social media. And what that's done is it's made us realize that we haven't got as far as we thought we had. If you take, for example, the 2012 opening ceremony of the Olympics, that was a great kind of pageant, a celebration of diverse, multiracial Britain, at all its youth and creativity. The Empire Windrush was depicted coming through the stadium in Stratford. And it was a kind of high watermark, I think, of our belief that we were this country that were getting over race. We were finding a way of making our histories all work. And we were on this path towards being a sort of better nation. And then social media really took off. And what we saw was that there was a lot of people that didn't think that way. And they hadn't had the outlet. I think things in the longer historical span, there's no doubt things are getting better. But in the short term, it suddenly seems, because we have this toxicity coming from social media, I think it creates the impression that things are getting worse. So I think it's kind of a bit of both. It's quite a complicated picture.
But if the kind of history, that narrative wasn't told enough, let me ask, what drove you to get involved in this kind of work? What motivated you to study and document Black British history in the way that
I got into history for the kind of worst of all reasons. I was just obsessed with the Second World War, and there was war films everywhere. In the 70s and the 80s growing up, there was just war films absolutely everywhere. I mean, a feature of Christmas in those days was that the bridge over the River Kwai would be on television. I've never worked out why that was so Christmassy. Because war in Burma against the Japanese was a particularly Christmassy film, but it was everywhere. So I was just obsessed with the Second World War. And then one day my mother, who's white and Geordie, pointed out that there were Black soldiers in the Second World War, and I had literally no idea. So this thing I was interested in, history, and the idea of a search for a Black British identity, they coalesced because my mother drew the two things together. But this, you know, there was a kind of another reason, which is that I wanted to understand where these ideas came from, because these ideas really affected my life. When I was a 14-year-old boy, my family were driven out of our home in Gateshead by attacks by the National Front. There was bricks thrown through the windows for week after week. We lived behind boarded up windows. We lived in fear. It was a truly traumatic experience. And you know, during that experience, all I was thinking about was the trauma. I was just frightened. And we got moved to emergency housing and we had to leave our home. I didn't think about the meaning of that event till many years later. But when I started studying history and thinking about where these ideas about race and inferiority and superiority came from, I began to think about the kids who'd done this, because the people who'd attacked our home weren't much older than me and my siblings. They were from the same community. We grew up in the same streets, went to the same schools, and yet they decided in the mid-80s that they were going to attack a family who lived among them because they were a different skin color. And the idea that motivated young men to throw bricks through the glass windows of bedrooms in which children were sleeping was this idea of race. Now, I'm much, much older than those guys were then. But I, in my life, I've never encountered an idea or a theory or a cause or a concept that would lead me to think that the right moral thing to do was to throw bricks through the windows of children's bedrooms. And yet people I grew up with decided that that's what they were going to do. And now that takes a powerful idea to convince people to embark upon that course of action. So having recovered, I think, from the trauma of those events, I wanted to understand where these ideas come from. And to understand where the idea of race and racism came from, you have to go back to the histories of empire and slavery. And that's what I spent most of my career doing.
And how do we address those ideas in today's society?
Well, I think the first thing to do is to recognize that there are ideas, that racism is not the same as prejudice. Racism is a system, and it was created. It was invented. When we talk about structural racism, as an historian, I always go, well, of course, it's structural because it was constructed. These ideas were built. They have inventors and pioneers, and bits of them were added, new theories, new observations, new prejudices, new stereotypes. They were invented. I think the first step in trying to understand race and trying to understand how to combat race is to remember that these ideas are not innate. They're not natural. They haven't always existed. They were created from the 17th into the 19th, 20th centuries. And huge amounts of energy, human ingenuity, huge billions of hours of time, vast amounts of money were poured into creating these ideas and then spreading these ideas through society, through books, through literature, through music, through entertainment, through songs, through the early years of cinema, through the early years of animation. All of these cultural forces spread these ideas so that they became innate within our society, that we almost didn't question them. That when people met for the first time, often in the 20th century, Black people, they thought they knew them. They understood the nature of Black people because they had been told all of these ideas about Black people in Africa and Black people in America. They had a ready-made series of stereotypes with which to try to understand Black people. These ideas came from somewhere. They have inventors. They have people who are propagandists in their name. And we need to recognize that this is a man-made idea. And the great strength in recognizing that it was invented is, of course, that that means it can be dismantled. Race was constructed and it can be deconstructed. But the word of caution is it took centuries to create this idea and spread it across the world and spread it into our cultures and into our subconscious. It's going to take, I'm afraid, you know, great efforts across generations to deconstruct this idea. And it's also going to take the involvement of everybody, not just Black people. Because if we are serious, as I think millions of us are, I think the vast majority of us in this country are serious about wanting to live in a society that is not disfigured by racism and racial thinking and racial stereotypes, then it's the responsibility of all of us to combat these ideas actively, proactively. It's not just the responsibility of Black people to combat racism. It's not just the job of women to combat misogyny. If we're serious about wanting our society to move in these ways, we have to all get involved.
David, you're a filmmaker and clearly a far better musician than I ever will be. I also recognize the role that American film and music has played in our culture. And maybe that's my own upbringing, growing up in Trinidad Tobago and the exposure to the American arts. Has American culture, music, film, influenced the perception around Black history, even Black British history? Has that shaped Black British history's telling?
I think it has, but in a very specific way. I think it's in some ways made the Black British experience invisible, because the American story was always so much more vivid. Now, this is partly because American culture was just so dominant throughout the 20th century. It really was the century of Americana. But one of the effects of this is that people have a much closer cultural relationship with the African-American story than the British story. And also, we've preferred in this country for a long time to talk about American racism and American slavery rather than talk about British slavery. So the dates are significant here. It's 1807, Britain abolishes the slave trade. 1838, the enslaved people in the British Empire are given their freedom. Now, American slavery goes on until 1865. So Britain spends 30 years almost looking down on America because it is still a slave trade, a slave owning nation. At the same time, of course, Britain is buying the cotton produced by those enslaved people. So economically, it's up to its neck in American slavery. But from a sort of a national point of view, Britain sees itself as a nation that ends slavery. And there is this fascination, which is delivered through culture with America and African Americans and African American culture, which just suffocates the British story, because we didn't really want to engage with the British story, because we didn't want to talk British racism. We wanted to look at the American issue, because we don't have to feel bad or uncomfortable by looking at American racism. And that still pervades today. There's a thought exercise that some historians do, which is if you ask British people to think of the images that come to their mind when they think about slavery, what many people tend to describe are fields full of cotton and big houses, white houses at the end of avenues with, you know, Corinthian columns in front of them. That's American slavery. That's Gone with the Wind. That's 12 Years a Slave. That's more vivid in our imaginations than the forms of enslavement that your ancestors in Trinidad experienced, because we've whitewashed that story because it's difficult and we are complicit in it. And it talks about British people in being slave owners and slave traders and wealth from that exploitation coming back to Britain. The American story is one we can look at as spectators without having emotional, you know, challenge, any sort of discomfort about it. So I think the American story has suffocated the British story. And I used to see in Black History Month, you know, not that many years ago, a lot less now, you would go and see that community groups and schools would, for Black History Month, have pictures of Rosa Parks and Malcolm X and Martin Luther King on their walls. Now, I'm a huge admirer of all three of those wonderful African-American heroes. But, you know, they would know about the Montgomery, Alabama bus boycott, but they wouldn't know about the Bristol bus boycott led by British, Caribbean and African and Indian activists in 1963. So the American story slightly suffocated the Black British experience, and we're only now beginning to sort of to recover that story and place it within the mainstream narrative of British history. And that's why history is so contentious. This is why, you know, issues about what's taught in schools, what the National Trust does, what happens to statues are front page news, because this is a moment when the parts of our history that we just airbrushed out are returning. They're coming back up to the surface. And a lot of people find this really uncomfortable.
So how do you come to that with the claim in today's world that the Black Lives Matter movement, as so many footballers have supported, is an American problem? It's an American issue that the British have adopted. What's the counter to that?
Well, at the counter is history. Every time Black people in Britain have looked to America for inspiration, they've been told it's illegitimate. Every time British people talk about their experiences and find inspiration in the African-American story, they're told that it's an American issue. And this is not just Britain. This is across Europe. I think in some ways, the Black Lives Matter movement in Europe is incredibly important, because it was a moment when people rejected that idea. This is a British problem. One of the placards that the protesters carried last summer during the BLM protest said something really simple, something so simple it shouldn't need to be said, but it does need to be said. And it said simply, Britain is not innocent. Now, you need to say that because we've convinced ourselves so much that Britain is this exceptional country, always on the right side of history. And of course, America has a problem with race. Of course, America, in general, is a more violent society than European societies. But because things are worse in America doesn't mean things are okay for Black people here. And it's, what is the point? And how insensitive is it to say to a young Black person in London who stopped and searched 10 times the rate of a white person that, well, things are worse in America? How could we possibly say to the family of a Black British woman who's died after childbirth, when Black women in this country die at 5 times the rate of white women during childbirth or in the 5 weeks, 6 weeks afterwards? How can we say to her, well, mortality rates are worse in America? So what? Is that the best we can hope for, to be less racist than America? That's that summit of our ambitions, for the lives of Black people to be less damaged in this country than they are in the United States? It's got nothing to do with these pointless comparisons, but this is what we've always done. When we talk about racism, we go, it's worse in America. When we try and talk about the empire, people will say, well, the empire was worse. The Belgian empire was worse. The German empire was worse. When we talk about slavery, people say, well, American slavery was worse than British slavery. These attempts to relativize things away, what they really are is ways of silencing Black people. What they perform the function of just saying, stop talking about this stuff because it makes me feel uncomfortable. These are just devices. They're not real arguments. They're not real discussions. They're just a way of saying, a bit more politely, we don't want to talk about that. We want you to stop discussing these issues. It's just silencing.
You see there, Britain is not innocent. And I think that's a powerful statement, standalone statement. That British innocence, or perceived British innocence, is that what continues to drive the continued advocation for statues and monuments to slave traders? Is that what continues to motivate those who are calling for equality to take out actions against those statues and monuments? Where do you stand, and how do you perceive both the protest movement and the reaction to it?
Well, I think to understand what's happening about history and about memorials and statues, I think we need to realize this is a hugely generationally divisive issue. There are millions of people in Britain who are older and who were brought up in an education system and in a culture that told them that Britain was always on the right side of history, always on the side of the angels, that Britain is an exception that only ever done good. And anything bad that Britain did, as I said earlier, compared to the Belgians in the Congo or the Germans in Namibia, and it can be relativized away. And that this is a nation that can feel uniquely proud of its history. And the things that we expect from other nations shouldn't ask of ourselves. So most British people can understand to ask 43 million African Americans to live under the shadow of Confederate statues to Confederate generals who fought in the name of slavery, many of whom were slave owners, many of whom went on to be members of the Ku Klux Klan, that to ask African Americans to live under the shadow of those statues is outrageous, is a form of abuse. And the British people would expect that modern Germany would look at the statues that came out of the age of the Kaiser that led to the First World War, and of course the age of the Nazis that led to the Second World War, that Germany would always recognize that those statues are toxic and should never be on public display. And I think it's really important here to say it's not just the 12 years of the Third Reich. It's also, you know, there are statues to the militarism that led to, you know, the First World War, a war in which far more British people died than any conflict in our history, that also shouldn't be on display. And if Germany decided to put those statues on display, we'd think they'd lost their minds. So we apply these ideas to other nations, and we're comfortable doing so. We expect them to understand that parts of their history cannot be uncritically celebrated. When people say, but what about our history? What about applying the same forensic scrutiny to our history? What about looking at who those men in bronze and marble are and what they did? Suddenly, this is frightening. This is not seen as the same process that happens in Germany or in other countries or in the United States. This is seen as an attack on Britain, an attack very often on white people. And if you have spent your life with an education system and a culture and a heritage industry that have told you that British history is just this wonderful panorama of heroes and victories and of mercy and of kind of wonderful acts, to be challenged with an idea that British history is like the history of any other nation, it's full of horrors as well as wonders, villains as well as heroes, that's very challenging, because many people have built a sense, part of their sense of identity, on this exceptionalism about Britain. And when faced with activists and historians saying, should we have statues to slave owners and slave traders? Should we celebrate Cecil Rhodes, a man who had a militarized police force that attacked African peoples and stripped them of their lands and their rights? Should we have a statue of Thomas Picton, who tortured a 14-year-old girl in Trinidad in the 19th century, the 18th century? Should we celebrate these people? Then, rather than engage with those arguments, it is easier, they find, apparently, it seems, to attack the messenger, to say that these activists are crazy, that they're Marxists, that they're extremists. It's easier to say that historians like myself are these kind of theoretical historians who live in this world of anti-European rhetoric, who hate white people. I mean, the fact I'm evidently, obviously, manifestly mixed race, every day I will be told on social media or in a newspaper that I hate white people, when that's evidently half of my family. But these arguments don't have to make sense, because again, what they're about is they're about silencing black people. It's about hushing down these conversations about history, because they interrupt this idea that British history is all good, it's all heroes and no villains, it's all wonder and no horror. And I think many people are so invested in that idea of a wonderful, exceptional British history that their reaction to that being challenged is to reject the history and to attack the historians and to attack the activists. So I have a lot of sympathy for people who, and I'm one of those people, who thinks we shouldn't uncritically celebrate everybody who our ancestors thought it was a good idea to put up a statue to, because often ancestors were wrong. And these arguments that are put forward in the defense, people will tell you that these statues were put up because people in the past lived by the standards of their time. That's the phrase we hear all the time. Well, very often, the reasons these statues were put up are much more complicated than that. And very often, these statues are much younger than we think. And they don't reflect the period in which these men lived. If I may go on, the statue to Edward Colston, toppled last year, that was put up in 1895. He died in 1721. It was put up for really complicated, quite strange reasons to do with the merchant elite families of Bristol wanting to maintain their position of power. It's got very little to do with the actual 17th century life of Edward Colston. So statues are strange objects. You remember them. Their back histories of why they were put up are often very complicated. But all I think people are saying is that we should apply to ourselves the standards we expect from other countries, that they do not uncritically celebrate the lives of men who did terrible things.
You touch on some of the ways that systemic racism continues to affect the Black community. You spoke about policing, you spoke about childbirth. We can apply that to so many different aspects of our life, corporate, education, whatever it may be. Maybe it's the footballer in me, but to a lot of people, it's easy to see life as a zero-sum game. And again, in footballing terms, for somebody to win 2-0, somebody has got to lose 2-0. How do you explain or how do you call for equality in today's world to somebody who only sees a greater recognizing of Black rights as the taking away of rights from white people? How do you explain to someone that because I uplift women and echo their own cause for equality, it does not mean that I am anti-man, let's say. What's the argument to that? How do I shape my response to them?
Well, I think that line of thinking is based on a mindset of complete individuality. Mm-hmm. The idea that the interests of women are a threat to interests of men. Well, the interests of your mother and her capacity to make a living and having a career had an impact upon you as a child. If you have a daughter, the idea that the empowerment of women is a threat to you, it is an opportunity to your daughter. That you have to have hyper-individualization to see the world in those terms. And I think something's true when it comes to race. That these arguments rest on an idea of them and us. Well, that's breaking down. Because of the level of interaction into marriage and the interracial population in this country, we're heading towards a nation, according to one projection, that by the middle of the century, one third of people are going to be minority, ethnic, or they're going to be mixed. And that means that the majority of us are going to have families that are interracial and cross-cultural. When we could visit each other's houses. When I go to someone's house and I see on the wall that big family gathering picture from the sort of wedding or the christening, what I so often see is that not everybody in that huge family gathering picture is of the same race. When I look at pictures of our family gatherings, there's people from all over the world, not just Nigerians. There's people from India. There's people from Iran. Our family, like millions of families, is multiracial. I mean, even I'm not sure they're planning on any big get-togethers, but even the royal family, their big family portrait is racially mixed. That's where we're heading, because each interracial couple is two extended families. And there's a story I often tell, which was a kind of real wake-up moment for me. About 10 years ago, I was walking on a beach, south coast of England, and I saw big guy, white British guy, bald, and he had tattoos. He had the England flag and he had the bulldog. Now, when I was growing up in Gateshead in the 70s and 80s, those were symbols that I was frightened of, and I was right to be frightened of. And if you lived through those years, you'll understand why. Because it was people who carried those symbols and bore those symbols who were a violent threat to me and who carried out violence against me. And this guy, I thought this guy was staring at me, and I'm afraid all of my sort of conditioning from my childhood kicked in. And then I worked out he wasn't staring at me, and I looked to my shoulder, and I presume his granddaughter was running out of the sea, a little mixed race girl, into his arms. And they kind of had a hug, and he was reassuring her. And I don't know who he was when he got those tattoos, but I know what those symbols meant at that time when he had those tattoos. And I, you know, that image of those symbols on those arms and that little mixed race girl was to me sort of just, you know, emblematic of the journey that I suspect that guy'd been on and that the nation's been on. Is that, you know, these ideas of them and us, that you need to believe that zero-sum mentality, they are breaking down. Because if you're young, if you're a kid at school in a city in Britain now, your school is full of people from all over the world. The musicians that you love, the people that you follow on YouTube and Instagram are all from all over the world. Your England team looks like your class. It's guys, you know, and the women's team from all over the world. These kids now, they are effortlessly global. They are innately diverse. It is the world in which they have been born. They've absorbed it. They just don't see anything or know anything different. They don't think in this mentality. So I think this mentality is going to die out because we are just becoming the nation that you can see if you walk into any junior school or any infant school in Britain now. If you want to see what the future looks like in 20 years' time, go to a junior school in London or Birmingham or Manchester and look at the kids. That's the country that we're going to become. So we are us. So this them and us thing, it just doesn't work anymore.
I've got just one final question, David. I'm going to ask you to combine both your historian and your filmmaker hats for me. 100 years in the future, where are we? And if you're making a film about 2020, 2021, what's the story you're telling?
Well, here's what I'd love the story to be. I would love, and there might be really good reasons to believe this, that 2020, the murder of George Floyd, the movement that rose up, was a fulcrum, one of those tipping points in history in which these ideas of understanding that we're in this together in a fight against racism, that racism is structural, that allyship is the way forward, that 2020 was the beginning of a victorious, maybe century-long struggle to get these ideas and draw the poison of these ideas out of our society. They took hundreds of years to build. Maybe 100 years is a decent estimate as to how long it will take to deconstruct them, to take them out of our society. And I mean, wouldn't it be great to make a history documentary about this thing called racism that used to exist in the olden days? I mean, wouldn't that be a thing for our great grandchildren to watch on their, whatever they're going to have then?
It truly would be. It'd be a wonderful film to watch and appreciate, especially as we sit here in this world today, just wondering what's next, wondering what tomorrow may look like. David, thank you very much for your time, for your candor, for your intellect, and for your efforts. These podcasts have changed me in ways that I did not expect or anticipate, and this has done so profoundly. Thank you so much for that.
We've been united by divisive events. We must use this moment to continue to make progress. Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. Show Racism the Red Card's annual Wear Red Day will be taking place on the 22nd of October. Wear red and raise money to fund anti-racism education across the UK. Together, we can make a difference. Text RED to 70470 to donate £1 and visit theredcard.org for more information.
Change hearts, change minds, change lives.